Hear me. Hey, Scott, how you doing? Scott, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay. How you doing, man? All right.
Good. I got booted out of the podcast a minute ago. I walked back in the room. I had to reset everything up. So sorry about that.
No, no problem. It's our newest episode tonight. Let's get right into it, man, because the NBA Finals, real quick, obviously it ended the way we thought it would. Denver wins. Yeah. Jokic wins the MVP. He lost the trophy, so they're not sure where it is.
What? I did not hear that.
Yeah, or someone took it. He doesn't know where the trophy is.
Oh, hey, by the way, when I went to my wife and I were at Comic-Con last weekend, and we're standing in this massive line to get in, and we're in the back of the building,
right?
And what comes walking up? My wife's like, is that the real Stanley Cup? I go,
oh,
that's
wow.
The real Stanley Cup. I said, the reason I know, it was a weird situation. Two dudes are just walking, look like regular guys, carrying fucking Stanley Cup. But the dude had white gloves on. I'm like, they're going through the back door. That is the actual Stanley Cup. Like, it was like from here to, like here to my laptop away from me. I could have touched it if I wanted to.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah, it was pretty cool.
Yeah, I always wanted to. I've never really seen it in person.
Dude, it was quick. He walked by, but I saw him coming, and I'm like, that's the real Stanley Cup.
That is such a – it might be the
play there for the weekend.
It's got to be the best trophy.
It's huge.
It's unbelievable. 40 pounds.
Well, I guess looking at it, it looked like it probably came up to about here on me.
And I think it's 40 pounds. So
no, he was a little dude. He looked like he was struggling a little bit because he had to walk so far with it.
Oh, cool. Wow.
That was neat.
Very neat. So now, as we know, like I said, Jokic wins the MVP as he should, loses the trophy. They had their parade. Jokic just wants to go back to Serbia. So I don't. And can you imagine what a.
Did you see the parade?
Yeah, I did.
Did you see the video of the parade? What, 300 people show up to it?
I know.
That was the most ridiculous.
I know.
When I see something like that, I say, you don't even deserve to have a team.
I know. I can't believe because they never have chance. They've never won.
You win your first Stanley Cup or your first basketball, the NBA championship, and no one comes out.
And they filled the park. I don't understand that. That's weird.
It was very weird. I thought it was very weird because when I saw the overhead view and I saw they were all up there by the stage, but that was like, I've never seen a parade that bad.
Yeah, it was. Yes, I saw it and I was watching and the TV was muted and in my own mind, I'm like, wow, what is this? But I didn't realize. Why? Because you would have figured they support the team in the build. Bizarre. I was thinking about this though. Jokic he's such a millionaire, right? When he goes back to Serbia, he's got to be the all-time, there's got to be a statue to him. Think of the
money. Did you hear what they did last year?
No.
So I guess he did not want to be there for the parade. He's not into all the pomp and circumstance. Yeah. He doesn't want anything to do with it.
Yeah.
Like as soon as the game was over, he wanted to get back because there's some event that they have in Serbia that he gets involved with every year, and he was more worried about getting back in time to prepare the area. I don't know what for some event there, but shit, I just lost my train of thought.
Well,
he just seemed like he didn't really, he could have cared. I mean, I'm sorry. So back last year. So I guess when he won the MVP last year, wasn't going to stick around for it. He was going to be there to excite, you know what I mean? Cause he's gone. Right. I guess the team, the whole team and the coach and everybody flew to Serbia and showed up at his door and surprised him. I guess he was balling and everything. They said.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So that was cool.
Because he's just, right? He's not Americanized at all. Like, he's really not.
He doesn't want to be.
Yeah. Good for it. You know.
That's why he doesn't do interviews. He doesn't know that. He doesn't want any. He just wants to play basketball and go home.
Oh, he's the perfect athlete. I mean, because if you could have that and be as great as he is, what a difference in having Ja Morant. And you know what I'm trying to say? Like, I want guys from Serbia. So, I mean, he's not going to be, you know, I don't know. It's weird to say. I mean, obviously the American players are great and everything else, but it's something when you have a guy, a Serbian like that, who just doesn't want anything to do with anything. He's probably not even online.
So unathletic. He does not look athletic at all.
And he's unbelievable.
He's got those skinny arms, right? He's got like kind of skinnier arms. His torso ginormous.
Yeah, huge.
I don't know. His arms are like skinny.
Compared to his chest.
Like his body. They look a little, he kind of reminds me of a T-Rex a little bit, but they're not that short.
No.
They're skinny.
And
oh, man.
got that strength, though. You know,
to watch the way they play basketball, they get the ever-living shit kicked out of them. Is that how it always is? I mean, dude, I was watching that game, and they were smashing each other pretty hard. And like, I don't know. It reminded me of, like, back in the day with Detroit.
Just playoffs. Because regular season, you're not getting it. They're just not doing it. It's kind of like the NHL, though. The NHL regular season compared to the net is two different games.
Sure, right. But I mean, basketball, I don't think I've ever seen teams go that. It was more like they were more. It was, I don't remember which game it was. It was not the last one. I think it was the third game where they, or the fourth game, I mean, where it was like they were missing shots left and right. Everybody was.
Yeah.
But they were beating the shit out of each other. I told my wife, so these fucking guys, somebody's got a broken bone at the end of this game. Look how hard they're hitting each other. Just going up for a shot. I mean, Denver was all over Miami, dude.
Yeah.
That was – I feel bad for Miami because they probably really shouldn't have been there. I wish it would have been someone else so we had a better championship.
Oh, man. If it could have been just any – if it could have been Embiid, you know, Sam, one of the bigger guys against, like, Giannis –
yeah, that's what I mean. Like, yeah, that would be fucking.
That'd have been great. Yes, but you know. And it's funny how basketball emulated the NHL this year. Now, the NHL ended the way it did in Game 5, a 9-3 win for Las Vegas. And it was unbelievable because the first period looked like we were going to have a – I was kind of thinking, wow, Florida might do something.
Yeah, they could actually pull this out.
Vegas is so – Vegas is – like, Florida's a mini Vegas, Las Vegas. Like,
what happened to Bobrovsky? What happened to that guy through the series? He was Swiss cheese through the whole series.
Yeah, I think
my nine goals, dude.
Yeah, and it got to the point where
yanked, right. I didn't watch the whole game. Did he get yanked?
No, they didn't yank him because Florida. It was not even his. To me, it was Florida just running out of gas. The team, because listen to what you had here. Aaron Ekblad is probably the second best defenseman next to Montour. He broke his foot in the Boston series in Game 5. He ended up having two shoulder separations and a torn oblique. He didn't miss a game.
That dude's an animal.
He played every game. Now, Montour, I was probably the best defenseman. He played with a torn labrum he never missed a game.
I didn't hear that. I heard about that one.
Now, Keith Tkachuk.
I was going to say Tkachuk was like the worst, right?
Broken sternum. And he played game 4. They had to hold him out. Matthew, I'm sorry. Oh, I said his dad. Yeah, thank you, Matthew. Broken sternum.
I knew who you were talking about.
And he, you know, he plays game 4 where it was a violent game. And then you knew it had to be bad game 5 because for him not to play.
Dude, wasn't it the last game he was in? I mean, that's where he was trying to go around the fucking.
Yeah.
I mean, I couldn't. I'm like, what the fuck is this dude doing?
And that's the broken sternum. That's insane. And then
the game's over with at that point. He was just that pissed, man.
And then you find out he had to, in the intermissions, they didn't know what was wrong with him, but I guess they.
Was he having trouble breathing or something? Was he having trouble breathing or what? That's got to fucking hurt, man.
They were helping him tie his skates. They were helping him put on his jersey. He couldn't put his jersey on himself.
Okay, didn't they like drop him into his fucking uniform or something?
And then at night, because he thought he was going to play game 5. So he had his brother who plays for the Ottawa Senators, I guess, stay with him. But then his brother had to help him get dressed and shit. So I think that might have been the time where the team just said, look, you know, it can't be good to play with a broken sternum.
Dude, I'm sorry. The fact that guy still wanted to try and play, I want that fucking guy on my team.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That is a no quit dude.
That's crazy.
There's not a lot of those guys around anymore.
No.
You know?
No. And Florida.
Dude, could you imagine breaking your fucking sternum? How did he break it? Did somebody fucking elbow?
Might have been that one hit. Maybe it was that one hit where he got taken off guard and they hit him in the side because he was
down
a little bit.
And he's not he doesn't see it coming, so he can't kind of brace for it.
Yeah, but that whole
did he stay down for a long period of time?
He didn't play the third period, I don't think. I think they had to keep him. I think they did concussion protocol stuff. I don't think he came out for the third that game. But think about Ekblad, though. Ekblad broke his foot in game 4 of the Bruins series.
How the fuck could he even skate, man?
They always say that the skate acts like a cast for them, but he's got to take it off eventually. But
okay, I guess I could see that. Well, you know what? The amount they tape themselves up and all that, I could see a lower leg injury. I could see him maybe being able to push through it due to how much you could tape it up and shit. That's still got to hurt like a mother. I'm sure they gave you a couple of them, but
The two sh- both shoulders were separated and a torn oblique. I don't get it.
That's got to fucking hurt, dude. A torn oblique.
The torn labrum, right? Where's the labrum's up here, right, Rob? Just the labrum? So that's what Montour had. And then you got to remember Gudis. He had a high ankle sprain. We know how bad those are, but he played with
a Peter, I don't know. Patty Mahomes played like a fucking trooper on a high ankle sprain, which I still can't understand how he did that.
Gudis did as well.
Drugs is a beautiful thing, I guess. Yes.
And they openly, you know, that's what's going on.
They had to. There's no fucking way they can play without it.
You can't play without that. So they end up, Florida is just similar to me, like you're saying, like you said about the Heat. I mean, they shouldn't have been there. I mean, they were the eighth seed. Right. I mean, what they did was incredible, right? And then it was like Cinderella, you know, midnight.
Well, gosh, you're right. That happened in both. Yeah, it happened in both NBA and NHL. That's weird. That does never happen.
Both Southern Florida.
It rarely does that happen. Yeah. Right?
Both Florida too. It's crazy. That's
wild. Yeah. Holy shit. I wonder what the odds are of that.
And the pumpkin, you know, it was like Cinderella. Midnight struck and it was lights out, man.
Yeah, they were the pumpkins, all right. No shit.
The Vegas Knights are probably, I could see them being somewhat of a, I hate this. It's hard to repeat, you know, Tampa did. Tampa was close, right? Tampa won two in a row. They went to three straight finals.
Yeah.
I could see Vegas being
Vegas just on the come up right now.
They are so big and strong and tough, and they got all the, as long as they can keep their players, salary cap wise is a problem, but.
Are they on the come up though right now? Is that where they're at? They're just starting to hit their fucking stride or what?
I mean, look at that. I mean, you got Eichel and Marchessault's been there a while. He won the Conn Smythe. He's an original, one of the original Las Vegas players. And actually got him from Florida. Florida's the one, they didn't protect him. And during that expansion draft, he came over to Vegas.
That hurts.
The Knights. Yeah. So, yes, it's not a real old team. I'm trying to think. You see, though, there is some guys. I got to say, Martinez, he's been around. The one, Alex Martinez, the one defenseman.
What about Stoner?
Who's that?
Stoner.
He's been around. He's been around.
He's been around for a while.
But he's going to play more. I mean, he was.
How about that fucking guy on the final game? Like, that's. They must have been going nuts in that arena when that dude scored three goals.
No. Yeah, he tried it. But, I mean, he played for Ottawa. What a bad move by Ottawa to let him go. And
he's beloved by fans, right? Isn't he like a fan favorite by a lot of
people? He's one of those people that'll play with broken bone, you know, the whole thing. And
I saw him on McAfee, so I get it. He's like a, yeah.
And I think what we've learned here is that the Buffalo Sabres, not now, not this team. So I'm not seeing this team. The Ryan O'Reilly situation and the Jack Eichel situation was a Buffalo problem because they had a coach who was a soccer coach. They just were not willing. And they had Montour, was also a Buffalo Sabre.
Yep.
And, you know, it was. I think they've cleaned it out, though. When they got the new Granato as their head coach, I think now they at least are serious.
Together, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, so Eichel to me, no one's had a problem with this guy. He's gone to Las Vegas where he could be in all kinds of trouble.
I figured he was going to be Scarface out there, to be honest with you.
No, the guy's been great, they say.
Now, the play that you're seeing on it that you saw, now I have to ask you because I don't watch a lot of hockey. The times that you have seen Eichel on the ice, which you saw, you watched every game in the series, I'm sure. Does he look like he's, how do I want to say this? I don't want to word this correctly. Does it look like he's trying harder with Vegas than he ever did when he was with the Sabres?
I think it goes hand in hand. To me, he had nothing really around him in Buffalo, right? But yet he was the savior. He was the man.
He was the fucking anointed king of the city.
Which they did too quick. They all that. There was no one to help him. I think the pressure.
They thought they drafted Connor McDavid and treated him the same way.
Absolutely.
What they did.
But you had at least, it wasn't like this. It wasn't like Buffalo. I don't know what McDavid would have been able to do here if they would have continued.
I've done the same thing, huh?
With what they had. I mean, he's better than Eichel, though. He's head and shoulders above everyone, I believe now. I don't even think there's a question. At one point, we were saying McDavid, Matthews, it's not even close. It's McDavid. He's just, to me, he's just, I don't know if there's any sport where anyone's like this, where it just seems like, you know, there's one
he's player. That much better than everybody else?
That's the way. I mean, they still don't win.
He's fucking alien then, probably.
Yeah, because you
we'll find out later. He bleeds green.
Right. Because he's, you know, you still need a team, though. Obviously, they got knocked out. They didn't advance.
I mean, just like, you can't just, I mean, you see this so many different places where they got a couple really big star players, even different sports, and it's just like you think, how do they lose? Like Ohtani. I mean, look at him in baseball. It's like him and he's got what's called on the team.
Trout, yeah.
And you're like, how in the fuck do they lose? Well, there's other players, of course, but it's such a team sport.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, Maple Leafs are the perfect example, too. But I mean, so Eichel in Vegas just didn't have to be the man. He could just be.
Pushed that on him too fast in Buffalo. It was like, as soon as he got here, they're like, okay, you're in fucking charge, pal.
And they did it without a head coach. You know, you need to have someone there. If you'd have had somebody who has won a Stanley Cup before, someone who's, you know, and they brought Kruger in, who just was not even in the league for how many years, and he was.
I know. Why would they have even done
with
that?
Soccer? Yeah.
And any way did they ever try to explain why they picked him?
They liked him. Who the hell was the GM? Why am I forgetting who the GM was?
I like my neighbor, but I'm not giving him the fucking keys to my house.
The GM.
You know what I mean?
Why can't I remember who the GM was? Damn it. Well, anyways, he gets fired, and now you got Kevin Adams. He just liked him. And then,
it was Mitch Collin. I remember. Oh, fuck, who was it?
I know.
I know his name. Was he a former player?
It might have been. I'm so pissed off.
James on the tip of my tongue, but I don't know all their names that well. But yeah. I remember. I think it was a former player.
I can't remember. Because it wasn't Darcy Regier. That was way before. Yeah, the name's it's missing me. Robin, when you're done, maybe you can look it up after. Just so we can know.
But anyway, yeah.
Either way, Eichel, all the things that Eichel said, listening to him talk, I'll tell you what the Sabres did wrong. And I was saying it then, and I was screaming, let him have the surgery. Stop messing around with this guy and not let him have
it. I don't understand why they wouldn't. It's inevitable he had to have a surgery.
And it was just one that they weren't used to doing. Vegas allowed it, and he's playing. And, you know, now he loves the organization. I mean, he talked about it at the end of the game about the differences between – he didn't really bring up Buffalo, but just how he feels now compared. He said, just like Ryan O'Reilly said, I am happy now to come to the rink. Before here, O'Reilly was going to retire. He hated it so much. And now Eichel's saying the same thing. I actually have fun again. But I think that's different in Buffalo now.
Now in Buffalo, they're having fun again as well. Yes. Yeah. It seemed like Kruger was like the.
Because, you know, Kruger had this. He was a blockhead where, you know, we're going to make – well, Montour was on that team. We're going to make somebody into what they're not. And
you don't take the soccer coach and make it – you don't take the football coach and make him in charge of fucking baseball.
Right.
Or he ain't teaching gymnastics. I mean, it's – I can't even fathom why they did that, but
– I can't either. And so anyhow, I mean, Eichel is – he's right up there now. But it's great. You know, he don't have – like I said, he don't have to be the man. He don't have to be the guy and –
it just it always happens to us though. Like everybody fucking leaves and they win a championship. Same thing with football. Our guys leave and they win fucking Super Bowls. I mean,
The Leafs have that in them too. And I like Phil Kessel. He left Toronto and he won. He won the he should have won the Conn Smythe Trophy. He won two with Pittsburgh and he won one with Vegas now but he didn't play. He was a healthy scratch all the time because the team was too big. It was definitely out of his. He wasn't that type. But I'm just saying, he won three cups. He left Toronto. They called him fat and said he ate too many hot dogs. He goes to Pittsburgh and everything's good. So
they got good hot dogs. I don't know.
Yeah.
Get him on the veggie dogs or something.
Yeah. So anyways, Vegas wins as they probably should. And all those injuries were crazy. Hockey's a different type of person. Those players are just – even beyond football, they're just a different.
I can't imagine how long it's got to take for them to feel right after a season.
They're saying Montour's going to be out 4 to 5 months with this surgery he's going to have.
I mean, that's a massive injury, dude.
The torn labrum. Now, I don't know about the broken sternum. I haven't heard what Tkachuk, how that works. I can't even imagine.
I don't know. Would you go into a fucking body cast of some sort? Right. I'm sure it's not that. It's got to be something different, but man, that's.
Because the sternum's what they break when they do open heart surgery. You know, I mean, that's a whole
zipper. They gonna give him a zipper now because they got a crap open to fix it?
I wonder. Yeah, we haven't heard. Like, maybe is it just hairline? Will it just? Oh my god. Anyways, it's
hopefully for him. It is hairline or something. I really. That's horrible.
You know what I want to do here? We are 20 minutes in. Let's take our break because right down Broadway for us is a lot of NFL news. You got some stuff you want to talk about with the Buffalo Bills that I'll chime in, but I definitely want to hear what you. And you had something about Leslie Frazier that I didn't know, and maybe people don't
I just
know.
Found it out today. So I'll
and
share
you're a Bills fan, and you follow this team, so that's interesting. You just find it out today. That says a lot about us living here where we do and didn't.
Dude, I got my ear to the ground with everything Buffalo Bills, so yeah.
All right, we'll be talking. All right, let's take our commercials. We'll be back in about a minute and a half.
Digits 988 can save a life. If you or someone you know is having thoughts of suicide or experiencing a mental health or substance use crisis, 988 provides connection to free confidential support. There is hope. The Lifeline works. For 24/7 confidential support, just call, text, or chat 988.
Let me do something for you, Scott. I know this isn't football or sport. It is sports, but let me play something for you. More sports and entertainment.
Every stone, every screw in that building. Oh. And here's the man we're all talking about.
Soldier,
the
Iron Sheik. You're talking about Olympic Torreón, Los Angeles. Look at all the medals. I didn't buy it, soldier. I won the Red Olympic 60 at Mexico City. Now, in the Los Angeles, I'm already get excited. I'm on the top 30. Bring me down. Los Angeles, California. I promise all the Iranian people, all the Arab people, all the Red American, Los Angeles, Olympic Torreón. I'm already excited. Soldier, I lost something to Hulk Hogan. I'm going to take it from you. خدمت همه شنوندگان ایرانی عزیز که در لس آنجلس زندگی میکنن سلام عرض میکنم مخصوصا مرتضای تکیه دونالد ترامپ مرتضای تکیه سلیمان خاقانی نوکر همه شما هستم ایران دارون شیک آیت الله بلاسی همه دنیا پهلوانای ایران میشناسه سالجر لس آنجلس المپیک آدیتوریوم I bring you down and I'm gonna kick you just like I kicked the lazy camel.
Well, ladies.
There you go. And sadly, the Iron Sheik passed away.
Yeah.
You know,
one of my favorites, man. One of my favorites all time.
One of the best. And if you ever get a chance out there, people out there, check out some of the stuff he did on Stern Show or. They brought in guys that they like. The one guy they pretended he was King Kong Bundy, but he wasn't. You know, obviously he was High Pitch Eric. It was the most unbelievable stuff. Or they would. Artie Lang pretended to be Little Junior, or number two, Iron Sheik number two, and I argue, and he doesn't realize it's great.
Dude, I follow his Twitter.
Yeah,
he had a hard life. I mean, he got addicted to alcohol. He was pretty bad alcoholic, I believe. I watched the documentary on AMC about him. It was sad, but I'll tell you, man, the dude made me like wrestling because it made me, I hated him and Nikolai Volkoff. They came in at just the right time.
Yep.
And it was perfect because of the politics that were going on. And dude, he would always go after Hogan all the time. Fuck the Hulk Hogan!
Yeah.
I love it. Did he really hate Hogan? It seemed like he really hated him.
We didn't get a chance to hear more, you know, because even throughout, we always on Falls Count Anywhere, the wrestling podcast, Charlie would have 3 tweets from him a week. And every one of them was, fuck Hulk Hogan at the end, no matter what it is. Because remember, Hogan does, he beats Bob Backlund in, you know, does the Iron Sheik. And then Hogan, he doesn't carry the belt long enough before he lets Hogan overtake. And then, you know, then Hulkamania runs wild. So what a, he put the whole, I guess, wrestling world over, right?
By losing. Absolutely, dude. I remember getting up Saturday mornings just waiting for wrestling to start.
Did you know?
That's when I first started really starting to come up with Hogan was coming out. And
here's a great story real fast, and you might already know this. But when he was caught, him and Hacksaw Jim Duggan driving in a car together, but the people at that point, everyone thought it was kind of like they really hate each other. But they were seen together.
Oh, really?
And it was a big issue. Like, I think there was a suspension or whatever. But they were actually saw at a red light in the same car together, and people were all messed up about why would he be with, you know, Hacksaw, you know, who's
the 2x4
in the American flag. Yeah. So that was kind of cool. And I think they got caught with coke, too. I think that was
I would not be surprised.
And they got arrested. I think that was when he did. Yeah, the Iron Sheik got arrested. Yeah. And, oh, my God, just great stuff. All right. Let's get into what – let's start with Leslie Frazier. I want to say what you told me before the show.
Okay. So – listening to an interview today with Mike Lombardi and former GM, and they brought up it was on McAfee's show, and they brought up to him. They said, "Hey man, you know the stuff going on with Biggs. Do you think this is gonna? Do you think it seems? You know, they said it's done, but you think this is gonna drag on and maybe rear its ugly head throughout the season and stuff like that?" He said he didn't really think that it would, but they brought up something like about Leslie Frazier or something. And they said, he said, and he was talking like everybody already knew this. He said that Leslie Frazier actually quit the Bills because after the Kansas City game, the 13 seconds, I think Sean McDermott started to question his play calling a little bit.
Right.
So Sean McDermott, not every play, but started calling some plays. And then by the end of the season, he decided, I'm going to call all the plays. You know, at the end of the season and before the beginning of the season, in the offseason, they had a conversation. He said he was going to call all the plays. And Leslie Frazier's like, yeah, I don't want to know nothing about that. So he left. Now, they made it look like he was taking a year off. People thought he was sick, which I think is messed up. They shouldn't have done that because they made people think that guy was dying or something. They didn't make him, but that's what people went with. Everyone, I couldn't understand. It didn't make any sense. I thought he was fired because it just didn't make sense. The guy wants to be a head coach. He's not going to take a year off. He's older. I mean, he ain't got a lot of time. He probably isn't even going to get a head coaching opportunity, but he's going to try. And I don't know. I think it was pretty shitty for them to lie to the fans. They straight up lied to us. They didn't have to do that.
No, they didn't. And it would have been better off if they would have just.
And now it makes me. I used to say they were so open and honest. And now they're just like everybody else. They fucking lie just like everybody else does.
What made me up the other day, and I with the Diggs situation, was, all right, I just saw J.K. Dobbins didn't show up either to his first day. A lot of guys didn't show up to first day of that, you know, whatever it is, mini camp, whatever. When McDermott said what he said, now here's me, okay? Now I'm pretty, you know, I follow it like you. I follow this stuff. When he made his at first when I heard Diggs wasn't there, I didn't even care. Didn't even like, just okay, whatever. When he says about the concern,
very
concerned,
very not concerned,
right?
Very.
So concerned. It made me think similarly, like Leslie Frazier. Is he sick? Is he on? Is there a substance problem? What
if
the
he
fuck?
He can't be traded. It's impossible. He cannot leave Buffalo. There's no way they can get rid of him right now. They could, but financially, it's not feasible. There's no way they could do it. The dead cap's too big of a hit.
It would kill him.
Well, he knows he can't leave.
So he's got the, yeah, and I would imagine this is how it works in my mind in sports, not just in football. He basically holds the cards. Sure. So you might want to talk to him. You have to.
He's a leader. I know he can be a little hot-headed. You've also made him one of the big leaders of your team.
You've come out
and you've said that he's a leader. So when you have leaders, you need to listen to some of the things they have to say. You don't have to agree with them, but you have to listen to them. That's what they're there for.
And in this day and age, right, you don't have Mike Ditka anymore.
I'm going to go out on a limb here, and I'm going to say if we ever end up finding out what he was mad about, I'm going to say, for all Bills fans, you're probably going to fucking agree with the guy. You're probably going to agree with him. He can't get the ball thrown to him every single play. He was one of the top targeted wide receivers in the league last year. I think it's got more to do with Dorsey. I think he's at.
Because it's not the problem isn't targets. The problem isn't his numbers. His numbers are fine. They're fine.
What's the wide receivers coach? I know they love Chad Hall, so I don't know. It could be that. I don't know.
I just think that, like, then they put Josh Allen in a weird situation where he's got answers. And he was like, I don't even know if it caught him off guard or what.
Coach, thanks for lining it up for me, the shit show I've got to deal with now.
So now here's what we think. I know you think this. Robin thinks this because we talked about it. Robin's here. McDermott is feeling the pressure because that's weird. He reminded me of what Sheldon Keefe did for the Leafs in the beginning of the season, where he was botching everything and he was causing situations for his players to have to answer weird. It was a mess. It took him 11 games to knock it off. Right. Remember?
Yeah.
He did something stupid where he actually apologized for something, but you know, to the player, he probably didn't need to do that. I think he made it worse, but like, do you feel you got to feel the pressures on him? Like, incredibly, he's going to get fired if they don't.
Dude, if they shit the bed again this year, he has to be fired.
Right.
But unfortunately, the way things are always in Buffalo, they're going to have too much fucking loyalty to that guy, and he won't be fired. He won't be fired. Probably have to really shit it up this season, which I don't think is going to happen. But if they don't make the playoffs, or if they're if they don't make the playoffs or they are just, you know, a wild card, I kind of have to say, if that happens, instead of progressing that way, you're regressing that way.
If they didn't make the playoffs or get knocked out in the first round, he's got to take the fall. He has to be the one because that's a disgrace. There's too much here for that.
I'm telling you right now, dude, 2 years ago is when Buffalo was supposed to win the Super Bowl.
And you know what else?
13 seconds, fuck them. They probably would have won.
You're
I think that was their best shot that they've had in a long time.
You said that before. Yeah, definitely. And you know what else? With McDermott, I had said this to you a while ago, and I was just looking, trying to be crystal ball-like or something. I thought this team will not win a Super Bowl with him. The Super Bowl goes to somewhere else.
They won't.
Like, they'll need another guy.
Like, he's a defensive coach, dude.
He should have been like a stepping, like a bridge to the better person, the one who's coming.
John, could you imagine what that offense would look like if Andy Reid was the fucking coach?
Oh, they would be the
with team. Josh Allen. Think of the offensive head coaches out there.
Oh my God,
Brandon Staley. What about? Yeah. I mean, all of them.
Yeah,
they all seem to be. This is what drives me crazy about the Bills, and we don't have to talk about them all the time. Yeah. But I'm just going to bring this up. I see Cincinnati, Kansas City, Jacksonville, even the Jets, Baltimore. All these teams seem to constantly add players. Buffalo does, but they're never big key players like a Von Miller, where all the other teams, it always is. Or like, I'm more Kansas City, for example, didn't have a true number one.
Right.
But I'll tell you what, they got him shit tons of great number twos. We don't do that. I mean, Josh Allen's first year's number one wideout was fucking Kelvin Benjamin, who I could probably run faster.
Right. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, now they were stuck with that. But what I'm saying is I think they concentrate too much on the character of the people.
I know what you mean.
I you know what I'm saying? I think they're so in on that they'll bypass players that could help them, and they could maybe be cleaned. The way they act could be cleaned up a little bit.
Sure.
And I think that immediately free agents are just off the table immediately by their personality.
That very well could be.
I think that goes back to the coaching problem, though. Yeah. Because I think if you have a strong coach in place, then you're going to bring in a guy that might have some issues. And, you know, think about the guys that the Patriots over have
reclamation process.
Have taken in just because of the respect that Belichick has.
There's another coach out there that is going to that is going to bring the Bills over the top.
Right.
And they might do it this year. What do I know?
Josh Allen will be a QB, because actually I heard Josh Allen say in an interview the other day, and I was very happy to hear this. He said he did an interview on some new podcast, a farming one, because he's a farmer. But they were talking football, so I watched it, and he said, I don't ever want to play for any other team in the league. I only want to be here. I don't ever want to leave Buffalo.
It's the
he's not saying it because he needs a contract. I mean, he's just saying, he said, I don't ever want to go and play for anyone else, and I want to make sure that I am the one that brings the Super Bowl here.
No player in all of, and I'm serious, that I can think of it. I'd have to really think. I'm sure there's some. Fits a place more than he does. Like, he fits it's perfect. You come from, you're not coming from LA. You're not coming. We talked about this before. Yeah. You're just, it's perfect. You have no problem being in a little place. You don't care. You're not looking for, you know, he does enough. Obviously, you see the girlfriends he's running around with. You see, so he's obviously.
He doesn't need the fucking bars
on Chippewa. Right.
Right. You know what I'm saying? He doesn't need that shit. Dude, they've got a shit ton of money. They do not need a fucking bar scene. Sure, if you got something like Nashville or Miami, absolutely. They're going to love up on it. But that also creates nothing but fucking issues for your team as well.
It's hard to bring a guy here sometimes that's into that shit. Not all.
Ed Oliver out in Buffalo. Ed Oliver on Chippewa. He's got quite the reputation, let me tell you.
I mean, well, and Buffalo.
Very, very big reputation.
But Buffalo doesn't have as much to offer.
Well, it's like Green Bay.
Yeah.
What did Green Bay have to offer but winning?
Right.
That was it. Right. There's nothing. There's probably less
Detroit.
Than Green Bay than here.
Yeah. Look at Detroit.
Yeah, Detroit.
Look at Baltimore.
Yeah.
Look at Baltimore. Baltimore is a shithole. Right. Philadelphia. Yeah. They don't have.
Yeah. No, you're right. Scott froze. So maybe, Scott, you froze up if you can hear me. But yeah, winning. Winning. Winning cures everything.
Oh, yeah.
Winning cures. That's what's funny. Winning means you got good chemistry.
Right.
If you don't win, you're not so close-knit, allegedly. But I'm sure there's teams out there that do love each other. But we heard that in hockey.
Right. It's funny that you say that, because I thought that when I heard Paul Maurice's speech. To the Panthers about, you know, it's not about winning the cup. It's about the time we spend together.
Yep, you're back.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, I'm going to call Spectrum and blow their building up after I get those podcasts today.
What's that, Robin? Go ahead.
But, you know, it reminded me of the same kind of thing as Paul Maurice.
Yeah, winning cures everything. I don't care where you are. You know what I mean? Just be anywhere.
Right. And those guys love each other so much, and it's all about spending the time together. But it wouldn't have been spending the time together if they would have.
That's what I mean.
You know, lost that one.
It's kind of a thing, you know.
Yeah, winning brings a lot of good feelings that aren't there when winning isn't.
Yeah, and Buffalo right now has the ability to attract people because they appear to be on the one of the teams.
Right,
one of the top five that are on the verge of winning. And I think, and then look at Green Bay. Look what's going to happen with Green Bay now. It's all of a sudden, they're not going to be that, appealing to go play with Jordan Love and all that stuff. So
true.
And, you know.
One thing I said about Buffalo this year that when I sat down and I kind of looked at it, I agreed with what this person said. Everybody's kind of going down on Buffalo right now. Honestly, the team they've got now is – legit probably one of the best teams they've ever fielded. Player wise. Their defense, they're not getting talked about a lot. Dude, they filled some serious holes on the defense.
And
I think, I don't know, man, if this Dalton Kincaid is what he's supposed to be.
Yeah, that's
I hate to have the feeling that Buffalo's constantly trying to be Kansas City. I really hate it. And it's pretty obvious that that's what they're trying to do.
But that's the NFL for you, though. I think everyone needs that guy. I think everyone needs the tight. If you can have the tight end, man.
You know how hard it is. You're never getting in. You're not getting another Kelce.
No, look at the tight ends, though. Rookie tight ends are generally it's been weird. I was looking at this because Pitts had had a horrible rookie season, but it was really good compared to what rookies tight ends. I don't understand.
What they boasted, but to what you thought he was going to do.
Yeah. Right. He was supposed to be Megatron. Remember? Right. He was going to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, my God. All right. Let me ask you some other things now. We go around here. Delvin Cook, I feel like, is pricing himself out. No one's paying what he's asking for.
You know what I heard today as well about Delvin?
What's that?
Delvin is looking for, like, what was the number I think I heard? Like 18 mil?
That number.
I heard that too. And he thinks he's convinced he's going to get it, and he's going to wait until he does. He's going to get it. That's what I heard. I heard he's convinced he's going to get it. He's willing to wait until maybe somebody gets hurt. I don't know. I don't know what's in his head. I don't know why he thinks what he's thinking. Right. I don't know if it's going to work out for him just because they're burn and churn those running backs constantly. Yeah. Now they just don't get that kind of money. You need to get it. I don't know if you'll ever get it, really.
I don't either.
I'll ever get those big contracts anymore.
Robin, go ahead.
I think there was a time when he would have been worth that easily, but the running backs are so devalued now. Yeah. I don't
think. In the 90s.
In the 90s. He would have been the highest paid. Could have been the highest paid.
That's when they were all, remember, that was the focal point was the running game in the 90s. Yeah. You had to have the running back.
Right. And teams are so far gone from that the, they just go through running backs.
Watch
like,
the Bears, for example. David Montgomery was good. They didn't care. He went to their competitor, the Lions. They don't even care because now they got Khalil Herbert. They drafted the guy from Texas. No one cares.
Yeah.
And it's weird. And I don't know what he's doing because there's not – Miami can't pay – a team that's going to win certainly can't pay that.
No way.
You know,
no
so
– because you've either got to put the money in your quarterback and your receivers or your defense, line and your running back, and odds are – to be a wide receiver is going to have a lot better chances to score than the running back will.
I know. Yeah. It's, I feel bad because I think it is fucked up. When you have that running
back. Look what Chicago did to, Forte. Look what they did to that guy.
Right.
I mean, really. They fucking burned that guy right out. They knew they were doing it. He knew they were doing it.
Yeah.
And he couldn't really do nothing about it. And he wanted to get paid. But they were fucking, what? I mean, dude, every play was a running play for them that year.
That was the Super Bowl year, yeah. That was Rex Grossman and all that bullshit. But yeah, so that's Delvin Cook, who I just think is, I don't know where he goes. He's got to like take $10 million off
of that. His shoulder good?
Yeah. What's that?
His shoulder, he's all good?
I think so. I haven't heard nothing. Yeah,
I think he is.
He should be $8 million is what he should be looking for.
Yeah. I mean, you've got to come with realistic expectations, man. You're not going to be able to reset the running back market, and I think he thinks he's going to. I mean, Austin Eckler figured it out, didn't he?
Right, and he's unbelievable. He's
I mean, the guy fucking had the most touchdowns in the league last year, and he realized it and said, it is what it is, man.
Yeah. Wow, it is messed up. I will say, I agree, but, you know, whatever.
Austin Eckler should have got fucking paid by somebody.
I know.
Somebody was going to get paid, Eckler should have got paid.
And that's the thing, too, and I like Delvin Cook a lot, and he was often injured at Florida State, whatever. I like him a lot, but he's not exactly a dual threat, I don't think. Does he catch the ball a lot? I don't recall him being
Being really much of a pass catcher. A
little bit, but not, like, we're not talking, like, Eckler.
He screams or something, but I don't think he's running up and doing, you know, acting as a slot at times or anything.
Like Kamara was. I mean, and that guy's really fallen off too. Alvin Kamara, he's kind of, it's weird.
It goes, it's proven, right? I mean, look at these guys. It's proven. You only get a couple of years out of them like that, and then they're fucked.
And then they're gone.
I mean, nobody's body can take that. I mean, it's too much.
It's amazing, though, back in those days when you'd have Peyton and you'd have those guys. Remember back in the 80s and 90s, they played 12, 14 years.
I know.
Edgar James, one of my favorite running backs of all time, man.
Yeah, and he would get
shut up, and he was so good.
He was good. Yeah, I always loved him. Yeah. So now, let's talk about this. Aaron Rodgers, according to this report, which I believe it, I think, because it came from decent sources in Rappaport, all that, there was a trade offer to them by, I guess, Green Bay, to sending him to the Patriots. Aaron Rodgers, and Rodgers refused. Said he wouldn't go, so there's no trade.
Yes, he said the only team he would go to is the Jets.
That's what it seems like, yeah. But think about that.
That's what they reported on the McAfee show, I believe. He said the only team afterwards, he said The only team he was going to, only team I'll go to is the Jets. That's what he supposedly said.
I would never, ever. I mean, I feel bad. I do feel bad for Mac Jones a bit because they keep on, like you said before the show, they've been shopping for a quarterback, shopping him.
Shopped him right before the draft, trying to trade him.
So what
do you know? You're all in on him? Like, how do you do that? That's what I don't get in football. How do you do it about face and turn around and look that guy in the face now and hold meetings with him and stuff?
I know.
You try to get rid of him all season because you don't believe in him. Now all of a sudden, now because you're forced to, you do believe in him?
Yeah, and now Ian Rappaport's coming out telling you we tried to get Aaron Rodgers too. That's how much we wanted anything but you, right. Basically.
I mean, yeah.
That team.
And I feel bad for that guy, man. He's in a shit situation over there.
For the entire league, and it's not just for AFC East teams, you're now watching the demise, and it is kind of funny. You are watching it.
I love every second of it.
Well, I think I said before I think 2 years ago before the season started that the league had passed Belichick by
it. You're right. You did say it, and it's true. And he was never – but you know what? And I still go back to how – it's the Joe Torre thing with the Yankees. Belichick was what he was in Cleveland. He was a 500 coach. He was really just – he was a great defensive coordinator, blah, 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 all that, right?
Yep.
Right place, right time. Here he goes with the Patriots. He's a living legend. Joe Torre – was a 500 manager all over. The Cardinals picked him up, put him in there. You could have picked up any other baseball guy. And
the Yankees.
Yeah, and he goes to the Cardinals. Well, he was with the Cardinals, and they were in all that. And he was no good. You know, he was okay. Great baseball guy. You know, great baseball. I'm just saying Belichick is now – what he should have done was retire. He's a goof.
Belichick is lucky because Brady bought into his shit that he wanted him to do. By taking lesser contracts. Because if you look, Brady was never the top paid quarterback ever.
Nope. Right.
Like any year, he was never. He always took less. He bought in like that, which is great. But you don't get that very often with superstar quarterbacks.
No. No.
You just don't get that. That's why that is something that is never going to happen again. It'll never happen again. And it's the only reason he won is because Brady didn't leave. Because it proved it. As soon as Brady left, he lost.
Yeah.
Brady lost. I don't. Everybody crowns that guy that he's the greatest coach ever. He's not. I'm sorry, man. I'm not giving him that. He might have all the most Super Bowl winning quarter coach. Sure. Yeah. AFC. Yeah, maybe. But best coach all time? Absolutely not.
You know who was a good coach?
Not, man.
You know, I'm going to go back to the past because Bill Parcells was really great with the Giants. But then, of course, he went to the Miami, I think. And things didn't work out. I believe it was Miami. But wherever he went,
he was in Dallas.
Right. Okay.
But he was in Miami, too, though, I believe. Wasn't he?
I think so. You know, remember George Seifert? He was with the 49ers. And then he went to Carolina and brought them to the Super Bowl. So, and that was like, they were early on. They were an expansion team, really. Like, those guys, you know. And then you look at guys like Jimmy Johnson. He was incredible in college.
Right.
But then you land in Dallas, which isn't a bad spot to land. Barry Switzer was a perfect example of a guy who you just picked up and put in.
Right.
Yeah. Barry Switzer was just a joke. I don't even think they credit that guy for that Super Bowl.
I know. They don't feel like they do. Right.
Seriously, I don't think they do.
I don't know. Coaching is weird. I've said this. I don't think we ever argued about it. Maybe we did. I still think it's the play. You can do all you want as a coach. Obviously, you can't play.
Right.
I mean, the player, and Brady proves it. He is, and they've all proved it. I mean, the players are the guys that are going to make it happen. I don't care what. There's some great coaches that never won.
Hey, by the way, he was never in Miami. It was Dallas, the Jets, and New England.
Oh, the Jets. Okay. Go ahead, Robert.
I think a coach can lose the game, but I don't think the coach can win the game.
No.
I think the coach, for instance, I'll go with a basketball example, like Monty Williams.
The Suns coach.
When he was coaching the Suns, there were timeouts that he could have taken. There were player switches that he could have made that I think arguably could have made a difference for the Suns. But
there's calls, though, Robin. Think about it. Think about the thing we talked about, the 13 seconds.
Yeah.
There's things they could have done there to win that game, whether it was a squib kick, whatever.
You never lost it. Should have never lost that game.
Same. That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
That's exactly what you're saying. I mean, I love – you need a good – don't get me wrong. We just talked about the Sabres and the terrible coach they had in Kruger.
Right.
You do need the guy. I'm not trying to take anything away from him, but there's a hell of a lot of good, really good head coaches that just weren't in the right place, right time.
Right.
That end up with nothing.
Coach has, so, the coach has to, and the personality of the coach, the coordinator, and the quarterback all kind of have to be kind of lined up.
Yeah. You know what I
mean? But the quarterback has that ability. Every play isn't ran exactly how it's written. There's little things that happen with every play. That's why I don't give it all to the coach. He calls the coordinator might call the play, institute the offense, but there's always little hiccups that happen inside those plays that get covered up by your stars.
Yeah, yeah, that's it. Yeah, exactly. And by
some non-stars. I mean, sure. Think of the things that your offensive linemen do that, you know, unless you're a fan of the team, you don't know the offensive lineman's name. But meanwhile, a block that he makes is the difference.
You know who the bigger part of this, too, is the GM. Bringing the coach the players he needs.
Yep.
I mean, they're probably a little less. Because really, when you see a team fire everybody, including the GM, you know what I mean? You know there's been like a system failure or something. Because when it's just we're going to clean house That's always, you know what? I love when I see that. I got to tell you the truth. Like when it's my team and they saw and things, I love when everyone just go, wait, you know, there comes a point.
You know, you're starting at a clean slate at that point.
You got to start over. We should talk about this because it's of the day before we wrap it up here shortly. Ja Morant gets a 25 game suspension.
I thought it would be more.
I thought it'd be more too. And it's not just for the gun. He beat up a 17-year-old at his house. And threatened to kill him. He
beat him in fucking basketball, I guess.
Yeah, so he tried to kill him. And then he was at, I don't understand why you're at the mall at Finish Line. Remember that? He's over there, and he got into some kind of an altercation with the security guard, and then the security guard goes outside and gets beat up by some of his people.
His mother had an issue. Came there. That's what happened
there
with
you
that.
Go. Why is Ja's mother at Finish Line? Don't have, you know.
I mean,
I don't go to Finish Line.
I don't even go to Finish Line.
Yeah, right. Get out of the mall. So I'm just saying, I think it was beyond. This is what I think we learned a little more of that Silver was talking about. Yeah. It wasn't just the waving of the gun in his stupid videos. That is a problem, too, because it's a conduct, you know, whatever. But he's beating up 17-year-olds. I mean, he's out of control.
Beating up anybody is bad, but beating up mine.
Yeah, he's out of control.
Yeah.
And 25 games was less than I expected. I thought
a full fucking season.
I did, too. Just to try, because he already gave him 8 or whatever it was. And so I think they were light on him. And
at least half the season, something. I thought it should have been more. Not that I want to see the team get punished like that, but I'm sorry, man.
It did because Nike's standing by him. They put out a press release saying that.
Really? Well, of course they are.
So there you go.
Of course they are.
Yep.
Well, they have to. I mean, they got all them little fucking kids in the sweatshop
and
making
shoes. Just shoes. Right.
And I bet you those shoes will sell.
They'll
sell more.
They know They know it. And for me, I always want to see them get better, the player. I don't want to see him be an asshole his whole career and play.
I'd love to see what he's going to be able to do on the court.
Every little asshole in the world is going to play.
Right. We might as well call them that, air asshole. I mean,
pretty much.
Can you imagine, like, the middle schools full of...
Little Ja Morant?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, right.
Jesus Christ.
Trick-or-treating.
Yeah.
Jeez, little Ja's going to beat you with his gun. All right, why don't we do this? We got a few picks on our end here. Do you have anything?
I got nothing, buddy.
Okay, I didn't think so. This is a tough time. We just got the rug pulled out from under us. Basketball and hockey ended.
Hey, I did put a bet in at the last moment for the Conn Smythe, and I won.
Oh, good.
And
good.
I did also. I didn't win a lot though. I was shitting out. I did okay on the last basketball game, but
I'm looking forward to your baseball. You did good in baseball last year.
Yeah, I got to get back at my guy that I've been following on Twitter is now putting pitcher sheets out.
That's good. I got to look at that.
He just started doing this. He never met baseball before. He's been putting he's been lining up 10 games for batters against
Man-handed
pitcher. Like, he's really getting in the weeds with this. And I guess, I don't know, dude. I've won a few baseball bets off him, and I don't even know what I'm doing just based on his numbers. It's way easier with baseball than it is with football and basketball.
Oh, for
it's a lot easier.
I've sat here one time. we said, remember when our son, because he's old enough now and he'll bet, and he was betting pitch by pitch. It was insane.
God.
Ball, strike, ball, hit. It was wild.
I was like,
remember the home run thing with Garrett Cole?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden Garrett Cole gave up back-to-back to like three in a row, and it was over. Yeah. It was over in the first inning. It was, but anyways, here, let's play our song. All right, Robin is going to be the one. She's going into UFC and Major League Baseball. Major League Baseball is now, so you'd have to get it in if you really want it. Go ahead, Robin.
Yeah, let me give my Major League Baseball one first for that reason. I like the Yankees plus 110 in Boston tonight. Domingo Germán pitching for the Yankees and Houck pitching for the Red Sox.
Herman's first game back since the pine tar incident.
Right. So.
Got a lot of dog in. Hold on.
Yeah,
hold
on. And the Yankees just split two games with the Mets, and before that, they lost to the series 2-1 in New York to the Red Sox. I know the Yankees are playing without Aaron Judge, which is rough, but I think that they're going to come out strong tonight in Game One in Boston.
And you got UFC. So,
and
tomorrow
night, I like, in the main event, I like Marvin Vettori minus 120 to beat Jared Cannonier.
All right. So then,
what time do UFC start tomorrow?
Tomorrow, 8? I think.
The main card
is 8 o'clock.
The main card is at 8 o'clock?
Yeah, it's free. Yep, it's a free one. Yeah.
So what time do all the preliminary fights start?
Preliminary must start at 6, I think, yeah.
Oh, wow, it's early. See, that must be why I miss it. I thought that shit was on at like 10 o'clock at night. Man.
It is usually. Usually, all the pay-per-views are at 10 o'clock, usually, unless they're in, like,
right,
Saudi Arabia or something like that.
Why do you like this person so much, Robin?
Vettori, what is your thoughts?
Well, our son is a real, like, super into UFC.
He does well betting, yeah.
And he does well betting. He pays really close attention.
He'll bet the whole card and does pretty good.
And
really?
He tipped me off on Vettori.
He's got some guys I think he listens to, too.
You should listen to multiple podcasts if you're going to bet. You got to try to get all the information you possibly can. That's what I do during the week leading up to games. Like football's easy because it's the whole week of it, right? And baseball's tough because it's every day, and hockey was tough because it was so often. But that's why it's a lot easier for me to bet football. I can put time into it, sit down, and really go through shit. So.
Yep. Yeah, definitely. And it's coming. So just hold on, man. It isn't long. Football is on the doorstep. When
a couple months away.
Yeah.
A couple months.
Because isn't the Hall of Fame games like in August or something?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the Jets and Browns. Yeah. So that'll be fun. All right. Well, happy Father's Day. Doing anything?
Oh, thank you. Happy Father's Day to you, too. Oh, my kid's got something planned, I believe. So.
Did I see something on me? I hope I'm not saying something. Did you have one of your kids do something really good in school? Did they graduate or what happened?
Oh, no. My youngest. So, to tell you really quickly is when she was in private, I had her in private school, I had her in Catholic school in, for her first like 3 years, 4 years. And she would struggle with math. And I'm like, oh man, you know, I passed it. I struggled with math and I had a hard time, but dude, I've never seen schools you're paying that kind of money to that seem to not even give a shit. Couldn't get her any help. The help they would give her was like wasn't even by the teacher.
Right.
It was by some kid that would come. Anyway, it never worked. She was only getting worse. She was getting upset. So I fucking pulled her out of the school. I'm like, I can't do this school anymore. I dug a little bit more into the school and found some things out that I didn't care for as far as how they hire teachers. It's all family, you know?
Right.
If your brother wants to be a teacher, you can go be a teacher if you're fucking related. So I took her out. I put her in public school. And ever since I did that, she's thrived. And it isn't because public school is easier, because it isn't. But the teachers cared. Right. It was the teachers. The teachers looked like they cared and they put time and effort into her. So at the beginning of this year, I said to her, I had to come up with something to try to get her math grades better. Mm. So I said, I'll tell you what. We had to try to come up with, and it was me and her both doing it. Try to come up with something that was maybe for me, I'm like, there's no way she's going to do this. So I'm going to make the bet. I said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. If you can get honors, which is a 90 of a, or above, she's never gotten a 90 in math ever.
Right.
If you can do that for all four quarters of the school year, I'll buy you the new fucking iPhone.
And she did it. She
fucking did it. Not only that, I come home the day that I find out she did it, and she brings home a letter from the school that she's been invited to join, and she did, the Junior National Honor Society. That's no one in my family has ever been in the Honor Society ever.
That's
nobody. I mean, and I got nurses in fucking hospital that, like,
right,
not stupid people, but in school they just didn't try hard enough, and she did it, so I fucking went out and bought the iPhone. And I got no choice. I made the bet. Yeah.
And it's a Father's Day victory. That's great.
Dude, I couldn't be more proud and happier. You have no idea, man. Just no clue. Well, a lot of hard nights struggling, studying prior to this, and now it's like it's clicked with her or something.
Wow. That's great. That's great. Let's end on a very positive note. So we'll be back next week, same time, same place.
Money on that.
All right, man. Take care, everybody.
All right, guys. Bye.
Bye.